BCS theory is a way of treating pairing, the formation of Cooper pairs of nucleons in opposite angular momentum states, and same angular in opposite directions, and doing that in the presence of many nucleons. It's the basic idea behind it is the lowering of the zero plus state that you get with residual interactions. But BCS takes account of the fact that there are many nucleons. So it's a non-collective aspect of the structure. Okay? It gives you something called the pairing gap, and you can need a nuclei, which is a gap between the ground state and the, what we call intrinsic states. But it's completely different than the IBA. The IBA is a model for collective behavior. Okay? One of the challenges of nuclear theory is, as you see, we have these different models for different regimes, near closed shells, far from closed shells, pairing, collective. It would be nice to have one single comprehensive model that was not so complicated that it couldn't be used. And with the data we're going to collect, or are collecting, on nuclear far stability, we have a hope of getting there. That's one of the goals, to develop a single comprehensive model. Next question. Yes?
I was wondering about the approach of the on the nuclear, like where you did statistical.
On what?
You did the statistical analysis approach to analyzing the nucleus. You said, okay, we have put on infinite nucleus, and this is how you said you analyzed it. And you said, okay, it's a compromise, but it doesn't really fall apart from reality. But I can't really understand because nuclei can, especially for small nuclei, that cannot be right. When you have only very few protons and neutrons, you cannot have such an approach.
Okay.
On a statistical basis.
You're referring mostly to what I was talking about with quantum phase transitions, I guess.
Yes.
Okay, so you're right in principle, but in practice there are ways around it that even for relatively small numbers of valence nucleons, say 15, 20, give you results that are very close to a very sharp phase transition. You saw the plots of R42 that went like this and then like this, and it's, okay, given that the axis here is an integer, neutron number, that's about as fast as you can go. There's a way around this business of integer neutron numbers. Instead of plotting the data against neutron number, you plot it against the energy of the first 2 plus state. And now in a given region, maybe you have 50 nuclei. And so instead of having 10 points along this axis, you have 50. And it's almost continuous. Okay. It's better. And then you see very sharp behavior. And so there are ways around it. It's been studied quite a bit, namely the approach to a real phase transition. With the IBA model, which for years only the maximum number of bosons you could use in it was 16, 32 valence nucleons, there are forms of the model, the code, that now go up to 1,000 bosons. Okay, now that doesn't correspond to real nuclei, but it allows you to study the behavior of the phase transition as a function of nucleon. And what you see is that obviously it gets sharper as you go up in valence nucleon number, but even by 20 valence nucleons, it's pretty good. Not perfect at all, but pretty good. Good enough that that's not the main problem. Okay?
So in some situations there actually exists an excited state in terms of isomer, which is deformed, and the ground state is spherical, and while adding neutrons or removing neutrons from the valence space, the two states approach at some point they switch places. And if you look only at the ground state, you will see a sharp phase transition, but actually if you look at the whole picture, it's a very smooth behavior. So how does this fit in the idea of first order, second order?
Okay, so if you remember, I showed a plot yesterday which which looked like this. It showed deformation and showed the ground state with zero deformation, and then a region of coexistence, and then only the deformed solution. So you talk about this region of coexistence, and if you look at the equilibrium deformation in the ground state, just the ground state, it goes like this, zero, and then jumps. That's a discontinuous change. If you look at the deformation of the excited state, it's here and then drops. Okay? What's happened is those states cross. If you look at both states together, what you see is this, like this. Now, you don't see this because it's integer neutron numbers. What you see is this, 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 this. Okay, and so that's the behavior of the phase transition. It's not infinitely sharp for the reasons that he was addressing, but you can actually track this, and you can do something else. The radius, let's call the equilibrium deformation, how the nucleus is different in the ground state and the excited state. There are ways to measure that, model independently. Okay, and these have been done in one case, and almost there's enough data for a second case, which verifies this picture. You actually see a crossing of the two deformations. You can also use reactions such as PT, proton, projectile, triton out, or TP, okay? And that probes exactly this similar kind of behavior. You can see this change from excited to ground state. Does that answer the question? Sort of. Okay. Other questions? Last chance. Going once, going twice. Sold. All right, so let's start. Pointed out two disagreements, these energies and the strengths of these transitions. And you, Nella, asked in the context of the IBA, what do you do if you find disagreement? And so I'm going to answer in the context of this instead, because this is a very nice example, so I added this in. So here you see these energies are further apart than the data. So what do? Is it just that these energies disagree, or is it something more specific? And here you see that these transitions are stronger than these. So can you go any further? And the answer is yes. So let's look at the ground state and the zero plus. And what you see is if you take the difference between the state of some spin and the ground state, and this second difference, they fall exactly on the X5 line for both ground and excited states. But that means, what that means is that even though these spacings are larger, the relative spacings relative to this 2 to 0 are exactly as predicted in X5. So that tells you it's a question of scale. In other words, there's one problem, not n problems, if we have n states. So that's a nice discovery, and it gives you a clue, it will give us a clue in a minute, about how to fix it. Okay, secondly, let's look at these transitions. If you look at these numbers, you'll see 91 and 33, you'll see 52 and 19, 13 and 6. And if you look, you will notice that for the most part, it's not 10 different problems, it's one problem again, it's the scale. These transitions are about 3 times more intense than these. Okay, and you can see that here I've normalized one of them, and here actually I've included 3 nuclei. And then the agreement with one stupid transition doesn't know how to behave. The agreement is really pretty good. Okay, so again that tells us something else, it's a question of scale. Okay, so why should the experimental transitions be weaker? And why should the energies be smaller? Okay. So let's look at those two issues. So here's the energies. Excuse me. X5 assumes a square wave. Well, you know that a square wave is an approximation. As you go up in energy, it's got to be somewhat sloped. So suppose you take the model width of the potential is not very different, so those energies will be about the same. For the higher states, the well is the potential well is considerably wider. That means the wavelength is longer, that means the energies are lower. And so very simply, just by invoking the idea of a slope well, you see immediately that these energies will go from large to small. And you can do it quantitatively. Mark Capriel has done that and shown that with an appropriate slope here, you don't lose the other agreement, but you get agreement on the energies. Okay? Now, what about the transition rates? Notice that R42 here is 2.91 in X5. Experimentally, it's 3.01. Okay? So it's a little closer to the rotor. Now, remember this. I borrowed this from our IBA discussion. Remember in SU3, one of the predictions of SU3 is that the BE2 values between these excited states and the ground state vanish. That means that as you approach a deformed rotor, these become much smaller. And so what you see here now is that since the real nucleus is a little beyond the critical point toward the rotor, these transitions have become weaker than these, and approximately by a constant factor. So by identifying the fact that these two disagreements are issues of scale only, we're able to identify the probable origin of them, namely that the well is not perfectly vertical, and that the agreement, the real nucleus is a little beyond the critical point. I think I say this. So this answers one question that was asked by you, namely, how do we act when a model doesn't work? Sometimes you learn something. Okay, so we're done with this. So that was that. That's me at the beginning. This is me as a graduate student. I should have asked you which one is me, but there I am. This guy is more famous. His name is Joe Allen, and after graduate school, he became an astronaut and went flying around the world. This is me on the Alex lecture in the Bernese Overland. This is me, my chemist, and this is me in Machu Picchu. Okay, that's enough of me. Oh, that's not me at all. That's my buddy. 2 pounds you are. Okay. So we've discussed the independent particle model, residual interaction, collective models. These together explain what nuclei are doing. Now I want to talk about why. In other words, what drives this structural evolution? Why does having more valence protons and neutrons cause nuclei to go deformed? There are many ingredients. Obviously, all of the interactions of all of the valence nucleons will contribute. But the dominant one by far is the proton-neutron interaction, the valence proton-neutron interaction. And we'll see that in a minute, but I just want to. What this interaction does is introduce configuration mixing. We talked about mixing leading to collectivity. Well, the proton-neutron interaction does it more than proton-proton or neutron-neutron, and so it leads to configuration mixing, collectivity, deformation. It's in competition with pairing. If you think about pairing for a minute, pairing is the formation of zero plus states out of two nucleons with their angular momentum like this. Zero plus states are spherically symmetric, and so those tend to keep the nucleus spherical, whereas proton-neutron interactions drive it deformed. Here's some of the history. The first idea was Maurice Goldhauer and, Amos de Chalit. And if you did 3 Talmy in 62, Federman and Tell, fundamental series of papers in the late 70s, and something else. Okay, we're talking about residual interactions, and we talked about how the zero plus state is lowered. There are 3 aspects I just want to cite here because they'll be relevant today. One is pairing, that's the coupling of 2 identical nucleons hanging on them 0. I just mentioned this. We saw an aspect of this in residual interactions for 2 valence nucleons where the lowest state is 0 plus. PN interactions in general, and I just said all this, so I don't have to say it again, and that's what we're going to talk about next. And the monopole component of the PN interaction. And this leads to changes in magic numbers. And we'll talk about that. So, pairing favors zero plus states. PN interactions in general, now I want to talk about those. So here's a plot of two plus energies in tin and in some other nuclei. And what do you see? Now don't look at the details, look at it, go back 50 meters. The data for the tin nuclei are constant, okay? As soon as you go to these other nuclei, the two plus energies drop dramatically as you go through these neutron numbers. Now what's going on? Here's 50, that's a magic neutron number, there's 82, magic. For the tin nuclei, the two plus energies are independent, more or less, of the number of valence neutrons. For these nuclei, they're not. What's different? Tin is magic in protons. So no matter how many neutrons you have, there's no valence proton-neutron interaction because there are no valence protons. As soon as you go to tellurium with 52 protons, or xenon with 54, or cadmium with two holes, there are protons and the proton-neutron interaction leads to the lowering of this state. Notice that when you have four valence protons, the lowering is more than when you have two. Okie dokie? This just says what I just said. These lower energies imply correlations and collectivity mixing due to residual interactions. Now I want to talk, and I'm going to come back to this, but I want to talk about the monopole component for a bit. And one way to introduce this is something I like very much, which is looking at data from different perspectives. So this comes back to a question you asked very early about two plus energies when I showed that they drop, and you notice that the gadolinium didn't behave similarly. So you're going to see this from a slightly different way now. So here's data you've seen already. And this shows for R42 exactly what you noticed for the two plus. Namely, as you go from 82, 84, and so on, neutron numbers going into the shell, R42 increases from 2, a little less than 2, up to 3.33. But it doesn't increase completely uniformly. And in fact, it's a crossing. So as you start off, nuclei, these symbols here, which are barium and cerium and so on, and neodymium, increase kind of smoothly all the way up. Nuclei like samarium and gadolinium, especially gadolinium, R42 increases very little, even though it has more protons. And then suddenly it snaps and goes to form very quickly. So does anybody have an idea why? What causes this difference between, say, barium and gadolinium? Would anyone like to know? Okay.
Gadolinium has more valence protons.
Yes, well, let's say it has 64 protons. And barium has 56 and the magic number is at 50.
Okay.
I'm not quite going to agree with your statement.
So now, okay, I know because I've seen a similar, I know it's similar, so it's not really the number of valence particles, but it's the number of pairs and it's the number of...
No, no, it's the number of valence particles. That comes in a little. That comes a little later. But the most important thing is the number of valence nucleons. So why is gadolinium behaving this way? Let's assume that the number of valence protons is absolutely important. That might suggest that gadolinium has fewer valence protons than barium, but it has 64 protons and barium has 56. And the magic number is at 50. So something's going on. Okay, if you look at exactly the same data, except plotted against N, against Z instead of N, you see the answer. Here what you see is the onset of deformation in some complicated way. Here, you see something really amazing. Same data. Look what you see. What you see is that for N equals 84, 86, and 88, you have these curves which are concave, and they have a minimum that's equal to 64. Okay? And for N90 and greater, they have a maximum that's equal to 64. You have this gap, You have concave and convex. That's the phase transition right there. So you see the onset of deformation, just like here, the R42 values become large. But you see it as a phase transition, concave to convex. And look at this. If R42 is a minimum that's equal to 64, z equals 64 must be a magic number. If it's a maximum at z equals 64, z equals 64 must be near mid-shell. So what we're seeing is a change in shell structure, where the proton number 64 changes from magic to mid-shell as a function of neutron number. So what we're seeing is the onset of deformation as a phase transition. Whoops. As a phase transition, mediated by a change in shell structure, and, oh, there was a line missing here, and driven by the proton-neutron interaction. It's obviously the proton-neutron interaction because it's a change in proton shell structure as a function of neutron number, 82, 84, 86, 88, 90, and so on. So what's the mechanism for that? The mechanism for that is what's called a monopole PN interaction, or is it, say, monopole. So here's the situation. This is a proton single particle shell model. These are the neutron orbits. Above n equals 82, the neutrons first start filling F7 halves and then H9 halves. The protons have a G7 halves, a D5 halves, and then there's a gap up to the H11 halves. So z equals 64 is like a magic number. And that's why when you have 82 and 84 and 86 neutrons, R42 for gadolinium is so small because you have an effect zero valence protons. Maybe it's not a perfect gap, maybe you have two valence protons, but you don't have 14. Now, once you start filling neutrons in the H9 halves orbit, H9 halves is spatially identical to H11 halves. It's just the spin orbit that's different. And so this neutron overlaps spatially tremendously with this proton. It's an attractive interaction, and that serves to lower the energy of the proton orbit as a function of neutron number. Wait, 1 second. And so by the time you get to about n equals 90, you have enough particles filling in here that this equals 64 gap suddenly disappears, and when that suddenly disappears, you change z equals 64 changes from magic to mid-shell. And so this is a structural change in the magic numbers, which is quasi-magic numbers, as a function of the proton-neutron interaction, which drives this phase transition. Yes?
I know this is a common way to look at it, but of course, looking at the, speaking in terms of single particle energies, comes into the trouble that you're no longer having independent particles to speak of single particle energies. So these energies are probably defined in a special way to reconcile the fact that there's a residual interaction and no longer only in the mean field, to define them as the original single particle energies. I think for me it's much more intuitive to think, and I'm not sure that it's not equivalent, to think that the gap doesn't change, but actually because the neutrons are now in an orbit that strongly interacts with the protons, it helps them, it pulls them to above the gap, about the same gap, because now the interaction of the new with the last neutrons with the protons is stronger.
Okay. So
I think I didn't phrase it very well.
No, but I know what you're saying. Let me make a couple of comments. First of all, you can still talk about single particle energies, but you have to take into account all the residual interactions. This is known, by the way, this idea has a name. It's called the Federmann-Mittell mechanism, after Federmann-Mittell, invented in the late 70s. And there have been microscopic calculations by people like Bobachevsky and others, which basically verify it. They argue that it's not solely H9 halves, H11 halves, but also I13 halves, H11 halves, and so on. So the details may be a little different. But the idea persists. You can also use G factors to measure the number of particles in these different orbits. And that verifies the idea. You can actually extract the number of valence protons by looking at G factors in certain ways. And it shows a sudden change in the occupation of the H11 atoms. Now, maybe that's equivalent to your picture. I don't know. I like to think of it in terms of a monopole proton neutron interaction. There's a third mechanism on the market, which is that by Hotsuka and some of the Japanese theorists who talk about tensor forces. But for a case where these are spin orbit partners, the tensor force and the monopole interaction are the same thing. Okay? Comes back now to the idea of fragility of the G-city. The magic numbers that we loved for half a century, well, some of you didn't love them because you're too young to have loved them, but those of us who have been around for forever, when I got my PhD, the big paper that year was the invention of the wheel. So those of us who have been around forever love these magic numbers, and now they seem to be going away, and a lot of that has to do with the proton-neutron interaction. Okay. Now I'm going to come to what you actually, who's you, right, about pairing and competition? Yeah. I want to talk about competition between pairing and the proton-neutron interaction. And I want to talk about estimating the properties of nuclei. So let's take a nucleus like fluorine-134. It's magic in neutrons, has two valence protons. If you don't know the structure of this nucleus by now, you have not been listening. Okay? It's a spherical nucleus. It's got a spectrum like 0 plus, 2 plus, 4 plus, 6 plus. Right? I hope you all know that by now. I've shown fluorine-134 about 18 times. Okay, what about dysprosium-170? Pretend that you're not reading this. It has its mid-shell in protons. Its mid-shell in neutrons. Neutrons are 82-126. That difference is 44. Half of that is 22. 82 and 22 is 104. So it's mid-shell. So you'd expect it to be the most collective thing you could ever imagine. So it's doubly mid-shell, should be very collective. Now I want to ask you, this little dot is fluorine-134, so its R42 value is very low. Dysprosium-170 is right in the middle there. So they behave exactly like what you'd expect. We actually don't know, 170 hasn't been studied. Okay. BE2 values, you've seen this plot many times, it goes up, maximizes near mid-shell, and this is the curve that led to your original question. So now, as you go away from closed shells, collectivity builds up. So now I want to ask you about these three nuclei. Tellurium-156 has 52 protons and 104 neutrons. Gadolinium-156, 6492, platinum-184, 78, and 106. If you notice, they all have 24 valence nucleons. They all have the same number of valence nucleons. Which one is the most collective and deformed? Someone turn on their microphone and tell me which banking.
I think gadolinium, because it has the most, the biggest combination of valence protons and neutrons.
Does anyone agree with that? Does anyone disagree with that? Okay, what do you think?
Well, I just for the, as you said, that the gadolinium would have something like a magic number that it shouldn't be collected.
Anybody else have a suggestion, or a thought, or a pulse?
So your question is, which is the most...
most deformed, most collective, which would have the largest BE2 value, the smallest 2 plus energy?
Yeah, maybe you were talking about this pair race between the similar...
I'm talking about data.
You don't see the data.
Which one would you expect? You're designing an experiment. You want to measure the 2 plus energy. So you set your detector gains to measure a certain range of 2 plus energies. Which one would you set at the lowest?
Mm-hmm.
Well, you're measuring lifetimes. Which one would you expect to have the shortest lifetime?
Right. I suppose platinum.
Platinum. Why?
Well, this 78 number is just below the 82, so we have quite a lot of excess protons, and we are also quite far away from the other medical rate too. But anyway, they might pair and you might still have not so collected, I don't know. But if I have better, better one.
Okay, so we've had suggestions for all three. I'm going to take a vote. Okay, you must vote. This is some kind of regime where you have to vote. And you have to vote with your hands way up high. Who says tellurium? Who says gadolinium? Who says button? Who didn't vote? Okay. All right, well, let's see what we can do. Okay, so what I want to do is exploit this idea that the PN interaction is dominant. And I want to talk about its competition with pairing. Okay, so if the PN interactions are so important, how can we exploit them? Let's make, again, the simplest possible model we could ever make. Let's assume, and what we're going to do is we're going to predict the behavior of any nucleus simply by multiplying two small integers. If you don't like that, you can do hundreds of hours of supercomputer calculations. The multiplying two small integers works better. Okay, so the assumption is that all proton-neutron interactions have identical strength, independent of what orbits the particles are in. Now that goes against a lot of what I've said. On the other hand, it's not such a bad approximation. So let's just assume that, okay? Maybe on average, if you have lots of interactions, that would be okay. So we're going to assume they don't depend on the orbits. How many valence proton-neutron interactions are there? If there are n sub p valence protons and n sub n valence neutrons, then the integrated pn interaction strength should scale as n p times n n. Is that clear? If you want to get fancy, you can say divide by 2. All right? That idea is called the NPN scheme. And let's look at whether it works. This shows two plus energies in the mass 100 region for strontium, zirconium, and so on up to gadolinium against neutron number. What you see here is that they're complicated. There are certainly trends, things coming down and stuff like that, but it's complicated. Now, over here, I'm going to take the same data, and plot it not against neutron number, but against neutron number, valence neutron number times valence proton number. And I get that. Wow! Look at that. All the data fall on a very nice smooth curve. Holy cow. Who knows that expression? Holy cow. Pretty good, okay. There's another one, the second word starts with S. Okay, look at that. Okay, now I'm going to do the same here. This is R42 in the platinum, osmium, tungsten region. This is the data against neutron number. And I'm going to do the same thing, but before I do it, I want you to tell me which nucleus here does not know how to behave. Which nucleus behaves in a stupid way? Or an anomalous way? This one? This one? I can't hear you. This one? Which is the one that behaves the worst? Maybe this one? So somebody tell me which one you think is the worst. Tell me where to point this thing. Left?
Left.
Up, down, left?
Down.
Okay, maybe this one with the alpha will be all too.
This? So a lot of you think this one's something this. Anybody think any others? How many of you think it's this one? If I told you it would be a very smart guess to say this one, how many of you would think it's this one? Okay, let's do an NPN plot. Whoa! Beautiful smooth curve with one nucleus named it is smooth, which does not know how to behave. So there are two messages here. One is that if you do an NPNN plot, you get a beautiful correlation of the data, okay, that allows you to understand how the structure evolves. And also, it allows you to find nuclei that didn't go to school and don't know how to behave. Now, in this case, we know the reason. Who knows the reason? People from Leuven should know the reason. Do you know the reason? It has to do with intruder states. Have you heard Mark Weiser or somebody talk about intruder states? Okay, it turns out there are two 4-plus states in the low-lying spectrum in Mercury 184. They mix and push each other apart. And there's another point down here if you average them, you come in and on. But that's not, I don't care about that because we're not talking about that subject. The point is that having a smooth correlation of the data allows you to find nuclei that are deviant. Okay? So another aspect of NPNN scheme is the following. Here is 2-plus energies in the mass 150, 180 region. And let's say we want to ask the properties of 142 xenon. It has 88 neutrons and 54 protons. So somebody tell me where you think, so that's going to be off here, roughly here. Where do you think the 2-plus energy of xenon 142 will be? I will raise this slowly and somebody tell me when to stop. You think up there. That's probably wrong. Okay, I will do it again. Did you say something? Now here's it. You think here. Why? Okay, so somebody said here, somebody said here. Why did you say here? The trend of 88. Very good. You said here. Why? Oh, you said like here. This one, this is 88. Anybody think anything different? Tell me what the energy of the 2-plus state is when you get to any z equals 50. Where is it? High. How do we know this hasn't turned around? How do we know that it hasn't gone down or up? We don't know. And the fundamental reason we don't know is because it's extrapolation. Right? Now let's look at an NPNN plot. An NPNN plot, this has 4 valence protons and this has 6 valence neutrons. 4 times 6 is? 24. Good. Here's the data in this region in an NPNN plot. And you will notice that it's all on a smooth curve, and that the value 24 is actually interpolation. This has a larger NPNN product than nuclei that are already known, and a smaller NPNN product than other nuclei that are already known. So to predict xenon 142 using NPNN, you just come down and that's your prediction. Now on this plot is an old plot, it was made before it was measured. But the actual measure value is exactly where the arrow is. So in the end, it can be useful in that way. Oh, now we come back to this. So, what's the NPNN product? 2 times 22 is 44. 14 times 10 is 140. 4 times 20 is 80. By the way, somebody said, you said, this should be the most because 78 has the most valence nucleons. You always count to the nearest closed shell. So it only has 4 holes. Okay, so you have 44, 140, and 80, and the answer is gadolinium. Okay, so you can use the NPNN scheme to predict any nucleus you want. And if you're right, you feel good. If you're wrong, it tells you something. Maybe it tells you about shell structure. If I had used this to predict the properties of 152 gadolinium, I would have gotten the wrong answer. If I assumed that the magic numbers were 50 and 82, I would have had the wrong answer because 88 neutrons, 60, blah, blah, blah. We're going to talk about this now. And we're going to talk about the competition of pairing. Okay, can we use this to estimate regions of changing gel structure? Remember, the pairing interaction drives nuclei spherical. The PN interaction drives nuclei deformed. Somehow life is a competition between those two. If you think back to the IBA, by the way, I had this two-term Hamiltonian epsilon ND and QQ. ND is the number of D bosons. Basically, that's coupling of them in a non-collective way. And the QQ term is coupling them in a collective way. Who has heard of the Ising model in condensed matter physics? Okay. Ising model is basically a simple model where the Hamiltonian with two terms, and as you change some parameter, one term grows, the other gets smaller, and they cross, the structure changes. In the IBA, that competition between the epsilon ND and the QQ term is like that. For small boson numbers, the epsilon ND term wins. As the number of boson numbers increases, the QQ term wins, and you change structure. Okay, similarly here, as the pairing interaction and the proton-neutron interaction vary with the number of valence nucleons, the structure will change. So let's see how that works. Let's look at this one called the P factor, which I think somebody mentioned. Maybe you? Somebody mentioned it. Maybe you didn't call it P factor. It's NPNN divided by NP plus NN. Now you know that NPNN is some kind of measure of the proton-neutron interaction. What about the pairing interaction? Think about pairing. In pairing, each nucleon interacts with another nucleon in exactly the opposite magnetic quantum number state and the same angular momentum, and they form a zero plus pair. So if I have a particle, let's say, in some orbit, and I have other protons and neutrons around, how many of those are there that couple to give you exactly zero? There's only one. It has to be in the same orbit, and it has to have the opposite magnetic substate. So the number of pairs is just proportional to the number of nucleons. So the pairing interaction scales with NP plus NN. And now from this alone, without any further thinking, you can immediately deduce a fundamental fact. As you get heavier and heavier in nuclei, the shells get bigger and bigger, the magic numbers get further apart. If they get further enough apart, if you have a shell that's big enough, every shell will have deformed nuclei. Because even if the coefficient of this term, in other words, the strength of the proton-neutron interaction, is much smaller than the strength of the pairing, which it is, eventually this product will win. Sorry? No, eventually this, the PN interaction, will be stronger than the pairing interaction. Because this product grows faster than the sun. Now, when that happens depends on the relative strength of each proton-neutron interaction, each pairing, and we'll see what that is in a minute. Okay, so this gives you a measure of the number of PN interactions and the number of pairing. I should have put the number of them. Okay, so it's PN interactions per pairing interaction. How strong are these interactions? The proton-neutron interaction is about 200 to 300 kilovolts. How do I know that? How do you know that? You don't. I know it because I know what the next slides are going to show. Okay, so you'll know it in a few minutes.
So but, from the same thing,
you can extract it from that. Okay, that's a model. We're actually going to measure it. Okay, but the answer is 200 kilovolts. What about the pairing interaction? Well, you can get an idea of the magnitude from these nuclei I've shown many times, which are two valence nuclei. The 2 plus state is somewhere around 1 to 1.5 MeV. That is not exactly the pairing interaction. Okay, I'm showing something under the rug. But it gives you an idea of the general scale. So, proton-neutron interaction is 200 to 300 kilovolts. Pairing interaction is 1 to 1.5 MeV. So, on average, it takes about 5 proton-neutron interactions with one pairing interaction. Okay? It takes five of my chihuahuas to beat up a bulldog. Okay? So each proton neutron interaction is small, but five of them can begin to win over a pairing interaction. So what you'd expect would be that when P is approximately five, you should have kind of the boundary between nuclei that are primarily spherical and those that are primarily deformed. Okay, here I make an NZ plot. Here are the stable nuclei, here's the proton drift line, neutron drift line. And these circles, or ellipses, or whatever they are, is the locus of nuclei that have P approximately five. So I would expect that this boundary, this one, would mark the region where the transition from spherical to deformed occurs. Spherical would be over here, deformed would be in here. Is that clear? So let's see how it works. Here's the data on R42. Here's this plot again. I'm going to compare this region with this region. So I'm going to compare that with that. And the next slide is going to overlap the two of them alternately. This is the R42 values. Deformed nuclei, spherical nuclei. That's the prediction. I just go back and forth to the screen. Are you convinced that it works?
Yes.
You want me to stop? I can't avoid it. It's going to happen a couple more times. Okay. All right. Okay, so you can use the NPNN scheme and the V factor to estimate the property of almost any nucleus. And if it works, as I said, you're happy. If it doesn't work, you learn something. Okay. I don't understand why this is in here twice. And I think I just forgot to remove this. Okay. So let's come back to obliteration or destruction of magic numbers due to the proton-neutron interaction, or due to the tensor interaction, or whatever, suggests that magicity is not the robust, strong, rigid concept we've always thought. And I just want to show you an example of some data. Whoops. These are 2 plus energies in some light nuclei. Here's neutron number 20, 28. Calcium has very high 2 plus energies. It has 20 protons. It's a nice doubly magic nucleus. 20 and 28 are good neutron magic numbers. But look what happens in magnesium, or here in silicon and sulfur. 2 plus energy just continues on down. What this tells you is that N equals 20 is not a magic number for magnesium. And N equals 28 is not a magic number for silicon. So these magic numbers move around. And whether you're a fan of the monopole PN interaction or a fan of tensor interactions, you get basically similar results. So the evolution of shell structure is one of the most important active areas of nuclear structure research today. And we haven't talked about it too much, but don't forget. This gives you a kind of summary of some nuclei. These are new magic numbers where we maybe would not have expected them, and the red ones are nuclei that we would have thought would have been magic, like 20 or 8, and turn out not to be magic. Okay, and this goes on, especially light nuclei, there are lots of examples. In heavy nuclei, the nuclei with Z equals 64 are a good example. In the zirconium region, Z equals 40 is a magic number that comes and goes as a function of neutron number. Okay, now coming to what you said, I want to measure, can we actually measure the proton-neutron interaction? And it turns out there's a very simple way, and this actually has been one of the results of some research here. Masses, as you know, reflect all nucleonic interactions. Mass differences, like separation energies, are very valuable. We've talked about that a little bit. I want to talk about double differences of masses. And I'm sorry, I have to go through this because I forgot to do it. Okay, if you look at double different, there's the concept of filters. Filters are functions of any quantity that isolates some specific effect. So a separation energy is a filter. It turns masses or binding energies into the energy required to remove a nucleon or two nucleons. So it tells you something about the single particle structure. Double differences of masses, Double differences of masses, depending on how they're chosen, can be used to isolate specific interactions. And I want to show you one which isolates the proton-neutron interaction. And here's the formula. 1/4 times the binding energy of the nucleus with Z protons and N neutrons, minus the binding energy of Zn minus 2, and then from that we subtract the difference between Z minus 2n and Z minus 2n minus 2. Now, is it completely obvious to all of you looking at this that this is the average proton-neutron interaction of the last proton and the last neutron? Good. So I'll explain it. Okay. These little cartoons show nucleons in Chelmon orbits. This orbit being filled corresponds to Z and Z minus 2 and N minus 2. Okay, if I have little things up here, that means Z is greater than Z minus 2 or N is greater than N minus 2. Okay? So this nucleus has two protons above Z minus 2 and two neutrons above N minus 2. I subtract the binding energy of the nucleus Zn minus 2. That has the same Z and missing these two neutrons. Physically, what is that difference? Well, what's different in these? The only thing that's different is this. So this difference of binding energy is the interaction of the last two neutrons, these guys, with everything else. So it's the interaction of the last two neutrons with Z protons, all of them, with N minus two neutrons, all of these, and with each other. Clear? Now we do the same thing here, except we do it with Z minus two protons. And now this difference then is the interaction of the last two neutrons with Z minus two protons. Just these, with N minus 2 neutrons, these, and with each other. Now we subtract them. And what do you get? You get the interaction of the last two neutrons with the last two protons. Okay? The factor of 4 gives you the average interaction. Factor of 1/4 gives you the average interaction of the last proton with the last neutron. This formula was first invented by Jerry Garrett and Jamie Zhang in 1988. We've been using it extensively for years. So here's the formula. Let me show you what this is actually mass data as of 1990. And I showed this for two reasons. Three reasons. So these are the interactions. And unless you're asleep, if I ask you what the most striking feature is, you would say these singularities. This is the one feature of the plot I'm not going to talk about. Okay. These are one nucleus for each element, and they correspond to nuclei with N equal to Z. That's a very special binding effect when in light nuclei with N equals Z. And the reason for that is the protons and neutrons of light nuclei are filling identical orbits, and when N equals Z, the proton-neutron interaction is incredibly strong. It's been explained with Wigner supermultiple theory, if any of you have encountered that. It's also been argued that that's not the explanation. But in any case, you get these. And the effects are huge for 2 MeV, 3 MeV. Okay. Other than that, the rest is pretty smooth. And if you remember, I said the NPNN scheme assumes that all the proton-neutron interactions are the same, regardless of orbit. And you see, that's not such a bad approximation. Now, the rest of what we're going to do, we're going to look at the fluctuations of these. Look here, this is around lead to awake, and you see 3 points, okay? In the next slide, I'm going to show you the situation today, a lot of recent mass measurements. But first, I want to do one last thing. These interactions are attractive, so they're negative. It's always very awkward to talk about bigger interactions that are going down in a plot. So for the rest of what I'm going to talk about, I'm going to change the sign and have them go up. So higher will be bigger. So this region looks like this. This, nowadays, looks like this. Actually, there's one more point here. Can we interpret this? This is a very clear pattern. Same pattern occurs Here, tin 132, this is your lead 208. You got a splitting and then a rejoining. So the explanation of this is incredibly simple. Think of the shell model. Think of 1582, 82, 126. If you look back at the shell model diagram, these shells always begin with orbits which are high J and low principal quantum number. Why? Because taking the harmonic oscillator and squaring it off lowered the high J orbits, and the spin orbit force also helps. The top of the orbit of the shells are low J and high principal quantum number. Okay? So now the neutron-proton interaction is short range and attractive. So if protons and neutrons are in similar orbits, then they will have strong overlaps and strong interactions. So we're going to use that idea. And this, by the way, is work of Virju and Shakirli, who's not here today. Okay, so here's the data, and here are these cartoons, and let's look at if we can understand it. Well, we can't, because something didn't show up. There we go. Okay, these nuclei here, if you take the time to look at the legend, are nuclei with Z less than or equal to 82, so they're filling the top here, and N less than 126, so they're filling the top here. So both the protons and neutrons are in low J orbits, high principal quantum number, very similar orbits like B a half, S a half, P3Ms, D3Ms. So they're highly overlapping when you have large proton-neutron interactions. Here you have nuclei with Z greater than 82, but N still less than 126, here's 126. And so now you have protons in high J orbits, neutrons in low J orbits, the overlap is much weaker, and so these points are smaller. Okay. Here, you now have protons above 82, neutrons above 126, so they're in similar orbits, the interactions are higher again, and so you can make a very simple explanation of this whole plot. Now, there's one region which we didn't talk about, and that's with protons above, protons below 82 and neutrons above. That means neutron-rich nuclei. The nucleus you'd want to look at would be lead-210. This is lead-208. Okay? So this would be protons filling just below 82, neutrons above. Would you expect a high point or a low point? Well, very good. You're getting into the okay, you expect, well, turns out this has been measured. It was measured not here, but at GSI. And the nucleus we want is the one with 128, lead 210. And we expect it to come down. And there's the data. A very nice confirmation of these ideas. Okay, dokie? All right. Now, I want to do something. Yes?
From this plot, can you then say that you expect the ones with PN interaction though to be less collective than the ones with high?
It's almost like I told you to ask that question. We're going to see that exactly now.
Okay.
Thank you. This is a similar plot. It's Z and N and it's color coded. And I don't think the colors show up very well here. They go from blue to red. Red values are large values, greater than 350 kilovolts. Blue ones are small, less than 250 kilovolts. Oh, by the way, I said earlier proton-neutron interactions 200 to 300 kilovolts. So now you see why I said that. Now, this is not, this central point is not lead 208 anymore. This is the whole proton shell, the whole neutron shell. So this would be lead 208 up there. This would be dysprosium 170. This would be tin 132. And if you think about this picture again, if the protons and neutrons are filling fractionally the same, they should be going through orbits that are highly overlapping, right? And therefore highly the large attractive interactions, right? Clear? And so in this spot, you should have the strongest interactions along the diagonal. And you should have weaker interactions. interactions off the domain. This is beta, and so that's exactly what you have. You have strong interactions along the diagonal, a little bit other places, but mostly along the diagonal, and weaker ones off. And by the way, so what you see then is empirical PN interaction strengths are indeed strongest along the diagonal. So all this fits together in a nice picture. For the lead case, with just a few valence nucleons, you can actually do show model calculations and verify it. Here you can't. You could do density functional theory calculations or something like that. But in any case, you have a very simple argument that motivates this. Also, PN interaction strengths are stronger in like regions than unlike. What I mean by like and unlike, this is the first half of the proton shell and the first half of the neutron shell. What we sometimes call particle particle. This is the second half of the proton shell, the second half of the neutron shell, This is the second half of the proton shell and the first half of the neutron shell. That's a particle O or O particle region. So this is an unlike region, this is a like region, this is a like region. So we expect in general a redder average color here and here than there, and that's exactly what you see. Okay. Now comes the answer to your question. Can we somehow relate this to the evolutionary structure? That was your question, right? Okay. Again, Shakira. Same plot. And what I plot down here is R42. So here's the same plot. These are R42 values. And these are R42 values not for the entire plot, but for these two quadrants. Okay? Now here you have large proton-neutron interactions, here you have small proton-neutron interactions. So you would expect that collectivity and coherence would grow faster in this region. Okay? The data, I've color-coded the R42 values. The red R42 values are nuclei from this quadrant, the blue ones are nuclei from this quadrant. They're plotted against NPN, but I could have plotted against other things. And what you see is indeed, they all go from spherical to deformed, but the ones in the red quadrant with the stronger proton-neutron interactions get deformed for smaller values of NPN because the interactions are on average stronger. That was your question, right? So that works really nicely. And that just says it. Okay, I just said a minute ago that it's very difficult to actually do realistic calculations for these because there's so many valence nucleons, but there's a model called density functional theory, and does anybody know about density functional theory? Okay. I have a slide explaining my view of density functional theory, but it's empty. So, because I don't understand it. Actually, what it shows is, here's my interpretation of density functional theory, and then the next clip shows an empty slide. And then the next click says, would you like to see it again? But I didn't show it. Anyway, density functional theory is an alternate way of doing kind of shell model calculation where you look at currents of nucleons instead of orbits. It doesn't matter. It works. Mm-hmm. So these are the experimental proton-neutron interaction energies. And these are from density functional theory. These calculations are carried out by Vitek Nazarevich, Project Satellite, and Marius Stoitzoff, who unfortunately died a few years ago. Yes?
Can you have some records if it means solid to have to how your thoughts?
Okay, let me finish one or two slides.
Okay,
so you can see that the agreement is really pretty remarkable. Not perfect, but pretty good. Experimentally getting these new nuclei is a job you guys will do with the solda and other facilities by measuring masses of neutron-rich nuclei. For the theorists, it's pretty easy, they just calculate. So there's no problem with them calculating everything. And now you have a bunch of predictions that can be tested. And for two nuclei, they've been tested. These two barium nuclei were measured here by Dennis Nieder et al. A few years ago, and they measured the masses that got dealt with the ends. The predictions are that they should be red boxes, and the data are red. So that's kind of nice. Okay. And now we're going to switch topics entirely and go to exotic nuclei, so this is a great time for a break. And when we come back, we'll do exotic nuclei, and then at the end, excuse me if I live that long, we will do some online IBA calculations. And I'll show you how you can do them either now or at home or in the mountains or okay, so it's 7 minutes after three. Let's meet back here. I will say at 3:15, but whatever time I say.
Thank you.
weekend in Japan, which is a really remarkable place. Triumph in Canada, NSCL at Michigan State, H of F, this is now closed, Gamil, GSI, and the new facility that's being built is EFRIG. This was made when we didn't know where EFRIG would be, so we put it in Kansas, just to be neutral. It's now going to be in MSU. Okay, this shows a kind of time chart of the world's major facilities. The thin bars represent facilities that exist. The thicker bars represent new construction projects. And this goes out to 2020. This was made about 5 years ago, so in general, everything is pushed a little bit that way. But you can see Isolda, ISAC 2, Skuranda, Fair, RIMF, that's Japan. These little symbols are when being on target happened. This is NSCL, HMF, which is stopped here. We should cut that arrow. This is Carolwood Atlas, which is a California source decaying. This is EFRIG, which is being built. Stable beams continue. There's a facility being planned in Korea, which may or may not exist, which is very ambitious. Probably too ambitious for the size of the country, but we'll see. Oh, and most of these are $500 million or €500 million facilities, so there's a lot of research effort. Okay, some themes. Some themes in the science. Okay, so these, I may have shown this. I have a feeling I've shown this because it looks familiar, but maybe I didn't. Anyway, these are two neutron separation energies for tin isotopes against neutron number. And it's a very interesting thing. The stars are the data. And the lines are different theories. You can pick your favorite theory. And what you notice is the theories, well, most of them, not this one, but most of them agree with the data remarkably well where the data exists. This is something theorists are very good at doing, predicting what they know. Who was it who said, I think it was Einstein or Yogi Berra? Predictions are very difficult, especially for the future. And so this is the future. As soon as you get to nuclei that are unknown, the theories diverge completely. This is what is known as asymptotic freedom for theorists. Okay, they can just predict whatever they want, and no one can disprove them for a long time. So, being a little more serious, if you can pin down some additional nuclei, you can begin to rule out some of these theories, and you can begin to pin down something more about the nuclei and where the drip lines are. Notice predictions of the drip lines are tin range from neutron number, I don't know what that is, 98 or so, to about 130. Okay. Yeah, okay. There are two features about exotic nuclei that I want to point out. There are lots more, but I just want to focus on two. Here's a potential well for the independent particle model. Suppose you have a normal orbit and a normal nucleus. It's got a wave function which is down near the bottom of the well. It's well confined, it's localized, and it's deep. Now you start adding neutrons. You start filling orbits that are higher and higher and higher and higher and higher. And what happens? Eventually you fill orbits near the top of the well. But quantum mechanically, they can extend beyond the well. They're no longer confined. So all of a sudden you get spatially extended wave functions. Okay? That shows up in halos and skin nuclei. If you look at these neutrons and the corresponding protons, they form a very coherent core, proton-neutron core, with a density that falls off sharply at some radius. But if, as you add neutrons, 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 they begin to fill outer radii, and their radii can extend to very large dimensions because they begin to be spatially extended when they get weakly. There's another thing. Remember, this potential well is an approximation where we say that all of the nucleons combine, they get together, they have a conference, and they decide what is the shape of the nuclear potential. That potential results from all the interactions of all the nucleons. And so you get a potential that looks like this. But what happens when some of the nucleons are up here and have spatially extended wave functions? Their contribution will be different And in fact, the new potential well will be diffuse. And it will be much more gradual, much gentler at the outer reaches than the one for normal nuclei via the valley of stability. So that means you'll get changes in single particle energies and magic numbers. If you put a particle in the well at this energy, it will have a very, at this energy above the bottom, it will have a very different wave function and energy than for confined to here. So as you go to the neutron-rich side, you expect the Schumann or independent particle models to change. Also residual interactions will change, lots of things. So as you get to new NZ range, you'll have interaction-induced changes in single particle energies, altered shell structure, regions of nearly pure neutron matter. There are halo nuclei like lithium 11. We have two valence neutrons out of here. If we can get to nuclei that are very neutron rich, like calcium or whatever, you can begin to get not just two nucleons, neutrons, out of this region, but maybe six or ten. You can develop an actual skin, like a shell. And that's a region of low density, diffuse, nearly pure neutron matter, which is a new form of matter. Here's a halo nucleus, and you've all seen this a million times. This is lithium 11, there's a lithium 9 core, two neutrons and large radii. The overall size of this is comparable to lead 208. It has a structure, it's a very hard to see, structure of Borman rings. You all know about Borman rings? Anybody know about Borman rings? Okay, good. There's a noble family in the north of Italy, north of Milan, called the Borromeos. And their symbol, their logo, is these three intersecting rings, such that if you remove any one of them, the other two fall apart. And so it's the same thing here. If you remove this neutron, this one also goes away. So this is a three-body system that's linked like this. They're called Borman nuclear symbols. Carbon-19 is the heaviest known proton, no, sorry, this statement is simply wrong. This is an old slide. Okay, once you can develop a, this shows neutron-proton densities for tin 100, where the number of protons and neutrons are equal, zinc 100, where it's 2.33, and you see a neutron density that extends to very large radii. That can lead to exotic situations where you have a neutron-proton core and a skin, and if they're weakly coupled, this core can oscillate against the skin, so you can get really exotic collective modes. You can have situations where the cores are formed and the skin is spherical, or vice versa. And this should lead to very interesting collective modes. This I already talked about, shell structure, we expect to change RF stability. This is some calculations by Otska, who used not a monocle PN interaction, but a tensor interaction. I'm sorry, what I just said was wrong. He predicts changes in single particle energies as a function of mass, like these. These are actually measured values, sorry. These are measured values for H9Ms and G7Ms as a function of neutron number. You can see them separating the new shell gaps in the period. That's the nucleonic foundation for everything. Nucleonic interactions, I didn't talk about pairing. Pairing can change PN interactions, new density regimes. I didn't talk about this, but as you fill nucleons in the topmost orbits of this, of the potential well, they can scatter to the continuum and go, bye-bye. Okay, and so you have to take into account scattering to the continuum. We expect new symmetries, phase transitions, critical points. The heaviest nuclei, I haven't talked about that very much, but I did mention that they shouldn't be bound, but they are due to quantum binding. Limits of nuclear existence, just finding out where the drip lines are. And of course, the links to astrophysics. Remember, the R process goes through neutron-rich nuclei. And unless we can get access to their masses and half-lives, we will never understand the R process. Oops. Okay, now this is what I'm going to skip. You can see what you're not learning. Oh, no, I do want to talk about one other thing here. This is an imaginary chart of the nucleides. And these are the nuclei that are sort of known. And these are, this is just a cartoon that indicates the beam intensities that you would get from some radioactive beam facility as you add neutrons. And the beam intensities close to stability will be large nanoamps. Somewhere around here, they might be 100,000 per second. And out here, they might be 100 per hour. Now, one feature of exotic beam facilities is to get to new nuclei. So let's look at this. This is a plot of beam intensity with current facilities and with some new facility. Okay? And all the red region corresponds to nuclei that are not available today, but will be available. So those are new nuclei. But that's only part of the story. The rest of the story is that for all of these nuclei, which are currently available, they will now be available with maybe 10 to the 3 times the beam intensity. So it changes everything. Instead of having 1 10 132 particle per second, you'll have 10 to the 6th. And as a function of intensity, the experiments that you can do get more and more sophisticated. If you have one particle per hour, you can probably measure a moment and a half-life. If you have 10,000, you can do reactions and so on. So don't forget that aspect of exotic nuclei. Here's the slide, which will be on the web. By the way, Maria, did you get my email last night with the third lecture? Is it up? Okay. All right. One last comment. Back to the Future. Who saw that movie? Okay, so what I mean by this is that when we do experiments with exotic nuclei, we're actually, in some ways, going back to the 60s and 70s. We're using techniques that have actually long been forgotten. When I grew up, everybody did beta decay, everybody did TP reactions, everybody did low energy Coulomb excitation. And then they got forgotten. People did heavy ion states with it. We're studying high spin states and so on. We all know about high spin states, right? But now we're going to go back and do these similar reactions, but on new nuclei. Now the reactions are similar conceptually. They'll be done in different ways, usually in what's called inverse kinematics. But the concept is the same. The challenge is that we're going to be having not 10 to the 9th particles per second, but 10 to 1 or 1 per hour. This just summarizes again some of the discovery potential and some spin-offs. And this, not at the end, but the rest is not going to be slides. This is some thanks to Cheryl and Ted Kazurich, Robert Jensen, Virgin Shakirli, who won the IU Batman Scientist Award, and all these other people. Okay, so now that's the end of the formal slides. What I want to try to do now, if I'm online still, is do some IBA calculations online. Before I do that, does anybody have any questions about what we're talking about? Oh, we can't do that. Yes. Turn your microphone on.
Hello. Previously, you talked about the P and N interaction. Just one thing that popped inside my mind about this isospin. Can you explain that about isospin?
Yeah.
Is there any relations to the P and N interactions?
Turn it off. Everything's related to everything. Isospin is a very important concept, especially light nuclei, relating to basically the differences in the number of protons and neutrons. I wouldn't say it's directly related to the PN interaction, although it is in some sense, but they're really pretty different concepts. A closer concept is F-spin, which is isospin for valence nucleons. Number of valence protons and number of valence neutrons. Okay. Other questions? If you have any, just ask. In the meantime, I'm going to try to go online. The main thing you need to know, and this is on the web already, what you need to do is you need to connect using Secure Shell to a computer called titan.physics.yale.edu, and the username is phy664. Port 22, that should appear automatically. And the password is nuclear_codes. It sounds like something that some bomb controller is in charge of, but it just means directory fint m. Okay? The IDA code is called fint. It stands for phonon interaction. The M stands for Mark Caprio, who put this particular version up. You all know the editor Pico? Anybody know the editor Pico? Okay, it's very simple because it's very intuitive.
It's the same as none.
Sorry?
It's the same as none.
As what?
None.
I don't know that.
None is different.
Okay. It's different than Emacs. But anyway, I'll show you how it works. And then you do run findm in the file name, and you can look at the output. So we'll go through this and do it. Here's the triangle. So we're going to try to find some position there. I remind you of this. If you want to reproduce U5, you just have this term. If you want to reproduce SU3, you have this term with chi equals minus square root of 7 over 2. If you want to reproduce this term, you have just this symmetry, you have this term with chi equals 0. There's the Hamiltonian, and everything I've talked about over the top of this. One thing to remember is that the natural size of this term is several hundred, several hundred kilovolts. Natural size of this is very small. So I've talked about a competition between this term and this term. That competition is not balanced when epsilon is equal to kappa. It's balanced when kappa is on the order of 10 kilovolts and epsilon is on the order of hundreds. So just remember that when you're trying to find parameters. Now, there are two parameters, chi, which occurs inside Q, and kappa over epsilon. But there are three quantities. There's chi, there's kappa, and the epsilon. What we do is we fix kappa at 0.02 MeV. The reason we do that is because we know that's a pretty good number. And then we vary just epsilon. At the end, we will have a set of energies whose relative numbers will agree or more or less with the data, but they may be off by a factor or two. And then you just take both epsilon and kappa and scale them. Okay, now here is the output. We'll actually do the calculation, but here is the calculation for U5. Now U5 just has epsilon, right? So epsilon equals 0.2, kappa 0, chi 0. NPH max is the number of bosons, so that's a calculation for 6. Can you see this at the back? IAM is the minimum angle of entry we want to calculate, so we start with 0 plus. IAM is the maximum, so this is a calculation that goes to 6 plus. The number of eigenfunctions is just the display option. Down here you'll see there are three wave functions, that just tells you how many. This you can more or less ignore, except for this t here. If print equals point t point, it prints out the wave functions. If it's point F, false, it doesn't print out the wave functions. I recommend you keep it at point T because you'll learn much more by looking at wave functions. Okay, this has to do with BE2s, and I will not get into that, but you can see the transition rates are predicted. That's the input. The output goes spin by spin. So first it does the results for spin 0, spin 1, and then 1 plus 8, spin 2, spin 3, spin 4, spin 5, spin 6. For each one of these, it lists the basis states. These are, and this is a calculation for 6 bosons. So these are the different ways you can make a 0 plus state with 6 bosons. You only need to know about the first two numbers. This is the number of the first three. This is the number of d bosons. This is the number of d bosons where there's angular minimum 2 or coupled oppositely to each other to give angular minimum 0. And these are the number of triplets, where they're coupled like this to angular minimum 0. So for example, the ground state, the lowest energy state for the Hamiltonian with only epsilon and d is going to occur when you have all s bosons, right? Because every d boson costs you epsilon in energy. Clear? This is the Hamiltonian. The bosons are either s bosons or d bosons. If I want the lowest energy, I'm going to have all s bosons. Because as soon as I have a d boson, it costs me epsilon in energy. So the lowest energy way of making 0 plus is 0 d bosons. should be able to deduce. We have epsilon of 0.2. Alright? This term is 0. We have epsilon of 0.2. So that means that if you have 0 d bosons, you have a ground state of energy 0. If you have 2 d bosons, you have a 0 plus state at 400 kilovolts. Right? Because there are 2 of them. Next 0 plus state would be at 600, and so on. And what you see here is 0, 400, 600, 800, and so on. These are the wave functions. You read the wave functions down. So for the ground state, the wave function is all no d bosons, right? Lowest energy will have no d bosons. And all these are 0. First excited state will have only basis state 2, which has 2 d bosons. Next excited state will have only 3 d bosons. So, is all this clear? The only energy in the system is the energy of the d boson. Okay? And then the same thing, a little less easy to see maybe, is for the higher spin states. This is a calculation for 06. Now you have a no epsilon term, and you have a kappa term, and that means that these basis states will be mixed. And so here you have the same basis states, here you have the energies, and now look at the wave function. The wave function of the ground state is a mixture of minus 0.433 times no d bosons, minus 0.75 times 2 d bosons, minus 0.491 times 4 d bosons, minus 0.094 times 7 d bosons. Okay? If I go to SU3, wave functions are even more complicated. Now I have all terms. Okay, so that gives you that. Now let's, we come back to that SH. And you type in that titan.physics.yale.edu, right? And username PHY664 and password and so on. I have a shortcut to it so you won't see each of those steps. But this will, in a second, ask for the password. So I do nuclear_codes. Okay. And the computer's called Titan. And so here I have the prompt. And now I'm going to say, now I don't know if you know these, you might want to write these down if you want. I'm going to do cd, create directory, fit m. Okay, everybody know about this?
Change
directory, sorry.
Like
those. Yeah. Okay, so now I'm in the fit m directory, if you want to see what's in there. There's that. Now, I suggest that if you do this, you create your own directory. But I happen to know that one of these files is called example 1. Okay, so I'm going to use example 1. So I do pico example 1.in. And there's the input. Okay, so let's discuss it. This input is incredibly simple. Here you put the value of epsilon. Here
you,
I'm sorry? I don't think it became bigger.
Yeah.
It's the same size. You just have more empty space. Okay. So here's epsilon. Here's kappa, 0.02. Here's chi, this number, minus 1.3223229, is minus square root of 702. And why that's the number that gives you SU3 is a deep result from group theory, which we won't go into. But, okay. 6 bosons, 0 plus up to 4 plus. We'll print out 4 wave functions. The only thing here is this 2. And then this is for transitions, which I don't really have time to go into. Maybe if you want to come by next week, we can do it, or email me, or whatever. Okay, so I'm going to change something just so you see what happens when you change it. What I'm going to do is add a 1, and then remove the 1, so it will think I've changed something. Now, if you look at that first slide that I showed earlier about Titan, it says what to do at this stage. You do control X. You might want to write this down. You do control X, and then it says, save modified buffer. OK? Okay, so I modified it. I modified it twice and put it back to where it was. So you type yes. And you hit enter. Whoops, I have it. It should have asked me if I wanted to change the file name. It did?
Yes.
Oh, did I hit enter twice by accident?
No,
okay. Alright, it's supposed to stop, it does. I must have done something wrong. It stops and asks you if you want to change the file name. Please change the file name and call it your name.in or something, okay? Alright, now I type run int m space example one. I don't need the dot in. And now when I do this, it's going to calculate. And you ask me how long it takes. There we go. Most of the time it's actually printed out. The calculation was done in a millisecond. So I can now look at that by scanning up. Okay, or it's a little more convenient sometimes to do pico example1.out. Because then I can scan down. So here's the input, repeat it again. Here's the input in another form that you don't need to understand. Here's zero plus state. Here are the six basis states. Here are the energies. Here are the wave functions. Okay. This is an SU3 calculation. So let's look. Here are two plus states. Now notice the first two plus state is at 45 kilovolts. Remember that number for a minute. Notice here there are two plus states at 705 kilovolts. Do you remember when I showed you the SU3 scheme? I said SU3 is not a general rotor, but it's a very specific one where the beta and gamma bands are degenerate. Remember that? Okay, here you see that. Okay, now, very important point. A property of any computer program that diagonalizes a matrix is that it's stupid. And what it does is it reduces the off-diagonal matrix elements to zero, but stops when they cross some small number, like 10 to the minus 8. Okay? Now, what happens if I have two degenerate levels that mix with an interaction of 10 to the minus 8? They mix totally. Remember, the mixing goes as the interaction divided by the energy separation. If the energy separation is zero, they will mix infinitely. So whenever you do an SU3 calculation, you will get wrong answers because these levels are exactly degenerate. And so if I do an SU3 calculation, I always put an epsilon in here of an electron volt or something. So 0.00001. That breaks the degeneracy. But that's not so important. Okay, now the 2 plus energy was what energy? 45 kilowatts. So what energy will the 4 plus be at? Huh? This is a rotor.
So 3.33 times
4. No, 3.33333.
Okay.
So what is that? What's 3.33333 times 45?
12.5.
What is it?
12.5.
12.5. What's 3 times 45 kilovolts? 3.33. Alright, that's a very complicated calculation. I realize that. Comes 150 kilovolts. This reproduces R42 exactly. Remember yesterday I told you that the energy spacing between the 0 plus and 2 plus was 6 times h bar squared over 2i, and the energy between the 2 plus and 3 plus was also 6. Okay, so let's go back here and look here are two 4 plus states at 810 kilovolts. Here's a 3 plus at 750. And I'm sorry, I didn't mean to show you. Here's 700. What am I doing? 705. Oh, sorry, I'm looking at it wrong. 705 for the 2 plus. The 3 plus should be 45 kilovolts higher, which is 750. Okay? This first 0 plus state is at 0. The second one is at 660. So the 2 plus above that should be 45 kilovolts higher, or 705. There it is. Okay? So you can easily derive some of these quantities. Now, let me go out of this, go back into Pico, and let me change the calculation and do 400 kilovolts for epsilon and 0 for kappa. Now it asks. Okay, so I'm going to call this, who asked for these? Now what? Is that the way it's spelled your name? Okay, and now we're going to run. Now there it is. Let's eco out. Okay, so now I have only epsilon, no kappa. I should have a, what kind of nucleus?
Spherical
vibrator. And the first 2 plus state should be at an energy of? Epsilon is
400.
Sorry?
412
epsilon is 400 kilovolts. So, ground state 0 plus. Now you see the wave functions are very simple. The wave functions are expanded in a U5 basis. Now I go to the 2 plus, first 2 plus is at 400 kilovolts, next is at 800, 2 phonon state, 3 phonon state, 4 phonon state, and so on. If the first 2 plus is at 400 kilovolts, the first 4 plus state should be at, somebody tell me quick, which is 800. Now, remember I asked you to calculate the allowed spins for 3 quadrupole bosons as homework? I know you did it, but okay. The answer was 6, 4, 3, and 2. You did it, okay. So for the first 3 plus state will be a 3 phonon state, so that should be 1200 kilovolts. 3 plus, 1200 kilovolts. Okay, now I want to do. Tiny kappa, 0.001. Okay? So I have almost just the epsilon term, and now let's look at the wave functions. Look at that. The wave functions begin to be mixed. And that's because the quadrupole operator has terms like S dagger D. So the product of them will have S dagger D, D dagger S. Or S dagger D, say. That will destroy 2D bosons and create 2S bosons. That will mix the first excited 0 plus state and the ground state. So you begin to get these components which are mixed. And you'll notice these two amplitudes are equal. That's basically those two mixing. There's some other small effects mixing with this. Okay? The energies now, the energy of the 0 plus is 0, of course, the energy of the 2 plus, instead of being 400 kilovolts, is 392. Notice it's come down. Mixing lowers the states. And now the 4 plus state will not be at exactly twice this energy. Twice this energy would be 384. Right? The 4 plus state will not be, I hope. Sorry, not 384, 784. The 4 plus state will be at 787. That's a ratio of a little more than 2. So we're starting to move from the vibrate. You know the grams a little more than 2? 2 times 392 is 784. So it's 3 kilovolts higher. We're starting to move from this corner of the triangle over here, larger and larger R42. That's a very small effect because I put in 1 kilovolt perturbation. Now let's change it to 10 kilovolts. You see how easy it is to do these. You get on a roll very quickly. Now look at the wave function. Whoa. Look how mixed they get to be for 10 kilovolt interaction. Now the 2 plus state is going from 400 kilovolts to 303, and the 4 plus energy will not be 606, it will be some other number, larger because it will be a 42 ratio greater than 2, 642. So now we're up at a 42 ratio of maybe 2.1, 2.15. Okay? Clear? One more calculation. Oh, it's 4 o'clock. All right. One more calculation quickly. So, what I'm going to change here is the boson number. I'm going to make it 16. The reason is you have this epsilon term and you have a QQ term. The epsilon term scales as the number of bosons, the QQ term scales in importance as the square. So I'm keeping the parameters constant, but I'm going to a boson number which is 2.5 times bigger. Square of that as well, so it's going to be bigger. So let's see what we get. Oh, I can say yes. Much longer calculation, by the way. It didn't look very long, but look at how. Now the base is 6. Now instead of having 6, there are 30. 16 bosons have 30 ways of making a 0 plus state. There are the energies. These are the waveforms. Look how mixed they are. Here's the 2 plus energy. If you remember, it was 303. It was 6 bosons. And in SU3, it was 45. It's gone all the way down to 48. And the 4 to 2 energy I don't know if all of you are here or if some of you are visiting, but if you're visiting, you want to email me the results or tell me the file name and the name of your directory, I can look at it in the comments. Okie dokie. If anybody wants, I can explain also next week how to do B2 values. The input is a little tricky, but it's straightforward. It's just you have to know what to write.
There's a manual for that?
There was no manual for it. It was written as part of Olaf Skolten's thesis in 1978. There actually is a manual, but the manual will drive you crazy because in 1978, that was in the late Neolithic time period, and we actually used cards with holes in them. And we'll talk about card images and columns, and so it will drive me crazy. But find someone who knows the answer. Are you here or are you visiting?
Me?
Yeah.
I'm
sorry?
I'm someone too.
So you're here?
Yeah.
So next week, come to my office and I'll show you how to do B2s. Okay, any other questions? Any questions? Any thoughts? Any sign of consciousness? Okay, we're done. Thank you.